Here in the valley of my soul, when I'm lost and all alone, through the shadows I can see your love is chasing after me. Oh, 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 oh. You cross the canyons of my fears, over the ocean of my tears, like the wind that moves the tree, your love is chasing after me. No mountain higher, no river wider, my heart may wander, your love will never stop chasing after me. Your love will never stop.
Jesus, Jesus. these bones to live and call these lungs to sing once again. Oh, I will praise my Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Your silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
The name we sing, oh, is
Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Your silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny.
Collage is hosting our next young adult event on Friday, September 25th at 7 p.m. in the Family Center. There'll be free food, live music, and a special message by Pastor Jordan entitled, Why Jesus?
This Thursday, we continue a new season of ministry to men and women. The ladies continue an in-depth and eye-opening seven-session Bible study by Jackie Hill Perry, focused on the New Testament book of Jude. The men's Bible study, entitled 33, focuses on understanding how your past impacts and shapes your present and future. Both studies happen every Thursday on our BVCC campus. For more information, go to bonitavalley.com.
The COVID-19 quarantine may have changed some things we do, but it hasn't changed who we are. Bonita Valley is still a connected community, even if we're doing it from distance by phone, on Zoom, or from behind a mask. We're still a caring community, helping and encouraging each other in creative new ways. And we're still a generous community. Your financial faithfulness continues to make ministry happen. even in these uncertain times. We couldn't do it without you. Remember, you can give online at bonitavalley.com/giving, by texting Bonita Valley to 77977, or by mailing your gift to BVCC 4744 Bonita Road, Bonita, California, 91902.
I want to welcome all of you who are here live and in person, and everyone who's watching online. We're excited about both groups. It's great to see you, and it's great to be seen by those online. As I was telling you a few weeks ago, we were able to track people that watch the services literally around the world. Vimeo, Facebook, YouTube, all the various social platforms we have, and we're able to track and see people that are watching them in so many countries and places. And so for all of you who are here and there, it is great to have you with us for this very special time together. And we are in a series simply called Playlists. Now, many of us, as we've been talking for several weeks now, we have playlists on our phone, different types of music, genres of music that we use for different activities. And I want to get us started this message with a question, and a country music question. Like I already told you that I listen to country music, and if you don't, what's wrong with you? Anyway, so I listen to country music, and here's my question. What do you get when you play a country song backwards? Well, Rascal Flatts, a country singer, answers that question in a country song called Backwards. In fact, here's it's a homemade video clip of Rascal Flatts' song, and just watch the screens.
I was sitting on a bar stool in a barbecue joint in Tennessee when this old boy walked in and he sat right down next to me. I could tell he'd been through some hard times. There were tear stains on his old shirt. Then he said, you want to know what you get when you play a country song backwards. You get your house back, you get your dog back, you get your best friend Jack back, you get your truck back, you get your hair back, you get your first and second wives back, your front porch swing, your pretty little thing, your bling, 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 and a diamond ring, you get your farm and the barn and the boat and the Harley, first night in jail with Charlie. It sounds a little crazy, a little scattered and absurd, but that's what you get when you play a country song backwards.
There you go. Some of you are wondering why you don't listen to more country music. See what you're missing. All right. How many of you have ever wished you could play your greatest, costliest failure backwards and get back everything it cost you, including your mind? Okay, have any of you ever wished you could reverse all those decisions that cost you so much? Well, if you've ever wished you could, and who of us have not had that wish, let me give you the good news and bad news. Let's start with the bad news. And bad news, in country language, it ain't never gonna happen. Or in proper English, it will never occur. Okay, so that can't take place, only in country music songs. But let me tell you what can happen. It's the good news. What can happen is while we can't get back things we've lost because of decisions we've made, we can recover. And we can experience an amazing life and an amazing future. That is the hope-filled message of Psalm 51. Psalm 51 is literally a recovering song. Not getting back everything we lost, but experiencing a life and a future that is absolutely hope-filled. It's written by David. And very honestly, it could not have been an easy song to write because he wrote it about the darkest, most difficult time of his life. But he shared it. And I'm so glad he did. And why he shared it was not just cathartic. It wasn't just trying to cleanse himself. He shared it because he knew he wasn't the only one who made a mistake they regretted. He wasn't the only one who made a major blunder, a major failure that cost him an untold. He knew he wasn't the only one. And because he was a leader, he wanted to help others experience the recovering that he experienced, the recovery. So he put it in a song, and it was to be taught to the nation. He put it in a song that we're going to talk about for the next few moments, because I believe Psalm 51 is one of those psalms. In fact, every psalm, all 150 are songs, but Psalm 51 needs to be on our playlist. And for a couple of very, very important reasons. And they're in your notes, okay? Like, if you have your phones, you can follow along, follow the service online. You can print it out. Those of you who like to take notes, if you don't, you can still just kind of follow along. But let's talk about Psalm 51. And one of the first things that it helps us with is this. The backstory of Psalm 51 helps us understand why we fail and mess up. Like, I'm not going to ask, have you ever messed up? I already know the answer. I'm not going to ask, have you ever failed? I already know the answer. We all have, and those of you who don't admit it, it's like that was your failure. So we all fail. But what I'm not sure of for you and me is that we always know why we fail. Let me just say right up front, failures and mistakes are not the biggest problem you and I have. In fact, failures and mistakes can help us in many, many ways if we'll learn from them. The biggest problem we have is not our problems and failures. The biggest problem we have is not learning from our failures, our costly mistakes and failures. And so this psalm helps us by giving us the backstory of the song. In fact, almost every psalm has a backstory, a reason why it was written. Some of them we're not really sure about. Others tell us right up front, and this is one of those psalms. In fact, in the Bible, I'm using the New Living Translation. It starts out by saying Psalm 51. It gives you the designation, and then it gives this description. Watch, Psalm 51, NLT, New Living Translation. It says, for the choir director. In other words, this is a song to be sung. A psalm of David tells us who wrote this song. Regarding the time Nathan the prophet came to him after David had committed adultery with Bathsheba. Kind of sounds like a country song already, right? Like somebody done somebody wrong song. It already started. So we are told before we ever get to the psalm, in a little direction for the choir director, we are given some directions for us about not only what David did, but why he did it. So, like, I'm not sure that all of us always know all these stories well. I grew up with so many of them. They've been part of my life. But I know that many of us haven't. And even if we have, it is so helpful to go back and rehearse familiar truths. So let's just talk for a moment, because the backstory of this psalm is told in 2 Samuel chapter 11. And we'll not take time to turn there. You can. Chapter 11, chapter 12, they're the backstory of Psalm 51. The better you understand the backstory, the better we understand the psalm and its application. So in 2 Samuel 11, we read that it's the spring when kings go out to war, but David doesn't go out to war. It's the spring when kings go out to kind of clean up the territory and their borders and reestablish it, and they lead their armies and kind of reestablish their kingdom. But David doesn't lead his soldiers into the cleanup operation. We find David just lying around. Was he bored? Was he restless? Was he a bit depressed? Maybe all of those things. But in the spring, when kings normally go do this, Scripture says David was doing nothing. He's bored, he's restless, so he begins to channel surf, web surf. Well, no, actually, they didn't have TV and they didn't have internet. Yeah. So he just gets up and takes a walk. How about that? And he's got a palace, and he's got a balcony. And his, if you've been to Jerusalem, as many of us have, and we've taken tours there, the city of David, his palace was the highest point, and houses down below it. And so he goes out on his balcony just to look over the city. And as he does that, he happens to spot a beautiful woman, and she's taking a bath. Now, he didn't do that intentionally. She didn't intentionally. And to spot her, it wasn't purposeful. It wasn't planned. And let me tell you, it wasn't sinful initially. If he had just looked at her and then looked away physically, mentally, just moved on, he would have been okay. But he didn't. And he wasn't. Instead of just moving on, he then wants to find out more about her. Can't get her out of his mind. So he sends someone, in fact, that's exactly what Scripture calls him, no name, just someone, find out about her. So someone comes back to David with some information, and here's what is told David. 2 Samuel 11, verse 3. She is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, and the wife of Uriah the Hittite. Now, there's a lot in this. There's a lot of description. See, this someone comes back to David and doesn't just give him a name. This someone comes back and says, this woman has a name. She's a real person. She's a daughter. David, you've got daughters. Hint, hint. She's someone's daughter. She's Eliam's daughter. David, she's a wife. You have a lot of those. She's someone's wife. She's Uriah's wife. Uriah is one of your special forces soldiers, and he's on the front line right now fighting for you. All of these words were not just informational, they were warnings. Now, this someone, a servant no doubt, did not have the clout to say, don't be stupid. But that's what he was trying to say. And God was using this someone to say to David, warning, 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 this is not a good move. But David ignored it. Okay, let's get real. It's you and me again. How many of you ever had a bad mistake in your life? And when you look back, there were warnings. There were like, do not enter. There were things that went on in your heartbeat and questions, but you just went right through. Well, that's what David does. David, in this backstory, does a lot of sending. He sends someone to find out who she is. He sends for Bathsheba. He sleeps with her. Then he sends her home. Night's done, go home. Scripture tells us David sent someone to get information. He sent someone to bring her. When he finds out she's pregnant, he sends for Uriah, her husband, from the front line, tries to send Uriah home so he would sleep with his wife and think the baby was his, but Uriah wouldn't go home. How can I go home and enjoy the comforts of my house and my wife when my soldiers are on the front line of battle? So David tries a second night and gets him drunk. Well, maybe drunk he'll lose like his values, but he doesn't. So David then gives him papers and sends him back to the front line and says, give this to Joab, the commander of the armies, and tell him. And he was actually carrying his death warrant. What David wrote in the papers Uriah was carrying was, put Uriah on the front line, right by the walls, and then back up. Now Joab knew this is stupid because that's where you die. You get on the front line by the walls, they throw things over, you die. You don't do that. David is telling me to kill this guy. But he does it. Uriah isn't the only one that's killed. Everyone with it, several were killed. And Joab's kind of ticked, and he sends word back to David. And David goes, well, you know, people die in battle. You find this word send. In fact, Eugene Peterson writes this. By following the use of the verb sent, we can trace David's descent from love and obedience into calculation and cruelty. Verb by verb, we watch David remove himself from compassionate listening and personal intimacy with God and others to position outside and above others and God, giving orders, exercising power. Let me tell you what happens. David stops worshiping and listening to God and starts playing God. Be very careful when you and I just start sending people like we're in charge of your life and my life. And all of a sudden, David stops listening and loving God and starts playing God, and it doesn't go so well. Because there's only one God, and you and I, we're not him. David thinks Uriah is killed, sin is covered, plan works. No one knew. In fact, Uriah is killed, and David actually marries this poor widow who's pregnant because her husband, what a king. Yeah, what a king. Got it. No one will know. He's dead. She has a baby. I married her. People all think I'm just amazing. But sin always has a bill that always comes due. It may not come due immediately, but there's a due date to every bill. Scripture says, be sure your sin bill will find you. How many creditors know where you live? And sin knows where you live. So David thinks it's all over, but now God sends the prophet Nathan to David. Now God sends someone. Now we're going to get to that in just a moment. But I want us to pause here in this backstory, because the backstory is given to us to not only help us think and understand what David did, but it really gives us some very needed insights into why he made such a mess of his life and why we do the same thing. See, Scripture gives us these pictures of people, because how many have figured out there's two ways to learn every lesson, the easy way and the hard way? The easy way is I learn from you. Have you ever seen someone do something stupid and you go, I am not going to do that? I hope you do. And others of us go, I'm going to do it myself. And so we learn it the hard way. And the Bible says we're given all of these stories to help us not repeat what they did when they did bad things, and to do what they did when they did good things, to learn from them. So I want to walk you through this just for a moment. And again, in your phones and your notes, if you're a note taker, I want to walk you through the whys of David's actions, and often the whys of ours. The whys of bad choice. Here's the first one in your note. Why reason number one? Losing God's vision, that's the word I want you to think. Losing God's vision for our life is often at the heart of wrong and costly decisions. I told you that it's the spring, kings go out to war, David stayed home. Why? Because he lost the vision of being a king. What is a vision? Well, let me take you back. Proverbs 29, verse 18. Where there is no, what? Vision. The people are unrestrained. It means there's no direction to their life. David was directionless because there was vision missing in his life. Let me give you a working definition of vision just so we're on the same page. A vision is a God-inspired picture of the future that inspires passion in us. A vision is a revelation. Actually, it was a horse person's term, a horseman's term in the Old Testament for directing a horse, the reins of a horse. And vision was to be directed, to be guided. In fact, that's why some newer translations, like the New Living Translation, translates Proverbs 29, 18 like this. When people do not accept divine guidance, see, that's the essence of vision, they run wild. But whoever obeys the law, whoever understands, the law is not just rules, it's the will and ways of God, is joyful. Doesn't rip them off, gives them the biggest, best life. And what happens is God gives us a revelation or a vision for every area of our life, for our marriages, for our families, our finances, our career, our ministries. God has a picture of your future that will inspire you. Enthusiasm means God in it. And when God is in the picture, there's enthusiasm and theos, God in it. It gives you passion, but it also gives you a sense of direction of where to go and where not to go. But David was experiencing vision drift. See, he received this vision from God when he was just a teenager of the king he was to be. But now he's like around 50 years of age. He's not a kid anymore. See, often our biggest danger is not when you get started. It's exciting to get started, and it's not when you're by the finish line, because the finish line is exciting. It's when you're in the middle. It's halfway points that are often such tripping points. I remember, when I was in high school and college, I had to run cross country. And I say have to because I had to. It was not my choice. I didn't volunteer. I want to be a cross-country runner. I played basketball on the basketball team, and that was a requirement to help get us in shape. So they made us do cross-country before basketball. And in college, it was 5 miles. My goal in running cross-country was never to be first and never to be last. I had no desire to win, and I had no desire to lose. And I was always excited when he took off, because we all take off. I'll tell you when I had my roughest point. About halfway through, I was usually by myself. And I would start thinking, why am I doing this? Come on, have you ever been in the middle of something and go, why am I still in school? Why am I still doing what I'm doing? Because vision leaks. It really does. Sometimes we get started because we see a picture so clearly it inspires us, and then we lose a sense of the picture and the inspiration. And I think that's where David was. I think that's where many of us end up, and it's a very vulnerable place to be, to lose a sense of the God vision, God picture of the future that inspires us. Let me give you a second. Why reason number two? Selective obedience is a costly wrong track decision. Selectively obeying what we want. Let me explain. In Deuteronomy chapter 17, through Moses, God gives the future kings of Israel three mandates, three orders. They're kind of like guardrails. He says, in the future, God knows everything. There's going to be kings. And here's what I want. I say to all of Israel's future kings, there are three things you are not to accumulate. You are not to accumulate many horses. You are not to accumulate, because horses had to do with battles. And if I get all this equipment and chariots and horses, I think, who needs God? I got horses. Horses can't save you. Chariots can't save you. God can. So don't accumulate secondary ways to win. Don't accumulate a lot of silver and gold. Don't fall in love with money. The love of money, it's not money's not a root of all evil, the love of money, because money can become a god. Whatever you think about most and spend most of your time trying to get and focused on, that's your god. And for many, it's money. And God says, kings, don't worship money. And then there's a third. Kings, don't accumulate many wives. Women. Don't accumulate a lot of wives. Now again, those who do, I have a question for you. Why? Anyway, so it's like a lot of wives. It's a lot of, I won't go there. So David did two out of three. David did not accumulate a lot of horses. He did not accumulate a lot of treasures for himself. But very early in his adult life, David began to add wives. He began to accumulate wives and women. It was an area of his life that he did not obey God. Years ago, I read a statement that I've never forgotten, and I hope I won't forget. And the statement is simply this. In our spiritual life, there are no sudden blowouts, only slow leaks. If you've ever seen somebody who spiritually crashed and burned, it wasn't instant. It didn't just happen in a moment. It was a slow leak. If you go back in your life and mine to the mistakes we made, you'll find out that it wasn't just that moment. That moment was the culmination. For David, he had not disciplined this area of his life for a long time. And now when he's in his 50s, it bites him. See, I got to ask you a question. God warned kings about accumulating wives. Did it make David any happier, more fulfilled, mentally, emotionally, sexually, to add so many wives? Apparently not, because he still looked for somebody else. See, sin is always deceiving. Temptation always deceives us. It plays this game on us. If I could just have a little bit more, I'd be satisfied. If I could just have a little more money or a little more fame or a little more this or time, a little more women, a little more men, all I need is a little more sex, a little more substance, a little more stimulants, a little more success. Just give me, I'll be happy. I got a question. Ask any addict how that worked out for him. Now skip that question. Ask yourself, because here's what I believe. I believe every one of us experienced addiction at some level, at some point in our life. Celebrate Recovery, an amazing group we have. One of the things about Celebrate Recovery is everybody, see, we write, I'm not addicted to drugs, but I'm addicted to a bad attitude. I'm not addicted to cocaine, but I can be addicted to criticism. There's all kinds of areas in our life that you and I fall into these repeating patterns. And the question is, does a little bit more satisfy me? No, it takes more and more to get less and less. I've talked with addicts and I've just seen them. They don't want to keep going, but they can't. They don't control their addiction. Their addiction controls them. And that's what began to happen to David. He was out of God's control and his control, out of his self-control. Let me give you another reason three. Being relationally disconnected increases our bad decision-making odds. If you'll read again the backstory, David during this season is alone. I don't mean totally immoral, but I mean he's relationally disconnected from meaningful relationships. He's got servants, he's got advisors, but they're not soul friends. David actually had one soul friend in his life, one soul friendship with Jonathan. And God just melted their souls, and Jonathan encouraged David in God's calling on his life. And when David wanted to give up on himself, Jonathan said, God has called you. You are going to be king. Jonathan encouraged David at times when he thought it's over, it's never going to happen. He needed Jonathan, but Jonathan had been killed in battle. And now David tries to just kind of go alone. Reminds me, Gordon MacDonald is a very effective minister, writer, leader. But several years back in his life, he had this moral failure, and it was not known for a while, and then it hit the light and hit the fan and kind of blew up his life. And looking back, Gordon MacDonald writes this, I now realize I was lacking in mutual accountability through personal relationships. We need friendships where one person regularly looks another person in the eye and asks hard questions about our moral life, our lust, our ambitions, our ego. And he realized that because he had no one like that in his life, he was more vulnerable. We all need a Jonathan or a Joanna or somebody who is, they don't work for us and they're not our boss. They are our soul connecting friend. If you don't have one, see, I believe it's a divine thing. Pray for it. That's why we have men's ministry, women's ministry, because it's smaller groups and they sit in groups. And you're going to just put yourself in environments and God will connect you with someone, because you and I are most vulnerable to making stupid choices when we are by ourselves. And we don't have someone to speak into our life to both help us be our best self and help us overcome our worst self. And we've all got both in us. All of us. And then one more. Why reason number four? Bad decisions often happen because we don't play the movie. I want you to write, play the movie. We talked about this concept previously. It's to look down the road of decisions and choices and ask, where will this take me? What will this cost me? Is it worth it? Now, I'll never forget, Chuck Swindoll is a great speaker, writer, kind of mentor for me in many ways. And I heard him talking one time about being, I believe he was in Canada doing a conference. Cynthia, his wife, was not with him. He was by himself. After one of the sessions he had finished, he got onto the elevator to go to his room. And the door opens and two beautiful women step on. And he had been a Marine, and he's a gentleman. And he says to the women, what floor? And they say to him, what floor are you going to? Chuck said, "My first thought was, I've still got it. And my second thought was, there goes my life. He said, my whole life flashed in front of me. I'd lose my wife, lose my family, lose my children, lose my respect from others, lose ministry. He played the movie. He played, what would this night of pleasure cost me? And he said, it is not worth it. And he got off the elevator and he walked the stairs to his floor. Why? Because he played the movie. See, temptation often asks us, don't deny God. You know there's a God. Just ignore him for a little while. Just ignore God. Just do what you want to do and don't play the movie. Don't look down the road. Because when we look down there, in fact, this is not a financial seminar, but it ties in. One of the recommendations I read once about people that have like an addiction to spending with their credit card is put your credit card in water and then freeze it. Okay, put it in the freezer. And then when you want to buy something, you got to get it out of the freezer and de-thaw it. Like you can't put it in the microwave, you'll melt it. So you have to wait. And while you're waiting, think. Now, do I really need this? I don't need this. I have five of these. Whatever it is, play the movie and ask yourself, is that where I want to be? Is it worth the cost? If it is, go for it. If it's not, say no. David did not play the movie. If he had played the movie, you never would have done the things that he did. He never would have had Uriah killed. And during this time, David, he thinks it's hidden, nobody knows. But David, he writes another psalm. We don't have time to go there. But Psalm 32 is David's psalm about how he was dealing with this, probably about a year's time. And he said, I was drying up on the inside. He said, all the juices of my life, they just all drained out. And God knew that David was dying, and he knew that his sin was killing him. So God sent Nathan. That's what the story tells. The prophet Nathan shows up. And it's David's personal pastor, and he shares a word picture, a story. Guys love stories. Like, I know women read books and guys love stories. Women read, 99% of books are read by women, and guys tell the story jokes. Like, women don't tell story jokes, but guys love stories, movies. So Nathan gives David, like, this visual mental movie. He tells about a very rich, very wealthy man who's going to throw a major party, and he needs to sacrifice. He wants to serve lamb. Instead of taking one of his own lambs, because he had so many, he was so wealthy, he took the only lamb of a poor family. And this lamb of the poor family wasn't just a lamb. It was like their family pet. And as he starts telling this story, David starts heating up. Because, I mean, David was a shepherd. Once a shepherd, always a shepherd. He'd been a shepherd when God called him. He had a shepherd's heart. He was shepherding Israel. And when he starts hearing about sheep, Nathan's got him. And when he hears about injustice, he's a king. He's got to stop that. And David is hooked. He is into this story. And David gets more and more angry. And finally, he says, that man ought to die. Now, nowhere in Scripture did it say that they should put you to death for stealing someone's lamb. But let me just give you a little heads up. It's amazing how overly harsh we can be on a sin in someone's life that's also in ours. How many times we are overly harsh about things for which we are guilty, but we see it in someone else, and we blast them. And then he says, well, yeah, we can't kill him, but he ought to pay back four times what he took. And then Nathan, the prophet, said, you are the man. Don't you hate when that happens? Like, I mean, come on. How many of you love, like, a great storyteller, preacher, pastor, but somebody tells something, and it's so good, you're like, oh, I wish so-and-so was here. They should hear that. I wish somebody was hearing this. And then God goes, it's you. David, to his credit, doesn't say it was Bathsheba's fault. I was depressed. David simply says three words. I have sinned. Nathan tells him there are consequences to your sin that you'll live with the rest of your life. See, the truth about it is there are things you can't get back. But then he says, God has forgiven you. You will not die. See, the sentence was death, but you will not die. God has forgiven you. Now, let me tell you something. This is so important. Forgiveness is instant. The moment you say, God, forgive me, you're forgiven. But restoration always takes time. Recovering is always a process. The moment you say, God, forgive me, you're forgiven whether you feel it or not. It's not based on your feelings. It's based on God's faithfulness. But there's a big difference between God forgiving us and recovering with God. And so David now writes Psalm 51. See, now all of that was introduction. Now we're getting to the message. You know, like, whoa. No, we'll go fast. All the backstory helps us understand what David did and why. And after this experience with the prophet Nathan, David writes a song. As painful as it was, he writes a song for his nation and for us. Here's how I recovered, and here's how you can recover. And he shows us in his psalm the process of recovering. And I'll walk you through it quickly. Okay, four things to write down. Here's the first one in your notes. First of all, recovering is always mercy-based. First word I want you to write, think, is mercy. Watch this. Psalm 51, verse 1, David says, have mercy on me, O God. Because of your unfailing love, because of your great compassion, blot out the stain of my sins. Now, this is so important. Recovering does not start with admitting our failure. As important as admitting our failure is, the possibility of recovering always begins with God's mercy. It's only because, see, David doesn't start off with, okay, God, I messed up, I need to talk to you about it. He starts off with, God, mercy me. His recovery began with the mercy of God. Now, many of us, like at church, we throw around terms all the time, and we're not always sure what they mean. We talk about grace and mercy, like they're the same thing, but they're different. Grace is a gift. We can't pay for it. It's a gift. You either receive or reject. Mercy is receiving a favor. It's receiving a release from something we do deserve, punishment. See, grace is the gift we don't deserve, and mercy is not receiving what we deserve, which is the wrath of God. Paul writes in Romans 9, verse 16, compassion doesn't originate in our bleeding hearts or moral sweat, but in God's mercy. David knew he deserved whatever God gave him, so he just said, God, mercy me. See, to receive mercy, and I was studying this for this psalm, and I was going through all the times in the New Testament, and it was just so amazing how many times, because God made this covenant promise of his mercy. God revealed himself, I am a merciful God. If I wasn't merciful, you wouldn't stand a chance. How many of you would rather have mercy than fairness? Because if God was fair, we are toast. Okay, like, I want justice. No, you don't. You want mercy. God, I need mercy. And how many times in Jesus' ministry, people cried out, Son of David, have mercy on me. Some of them knew I'm in a mess because I created this mess. I need your mercy in my life. And I want you to understand something. When God mercies us, it doesn't mean that no one pays our bill. It means that God pays our bill because we can't. On the cross, Jesus cried out, tetelestai. We talk about that. It means paid. That on the cross, God paid for our sin bill so that he could mercy us, not give us what we deserve because he took what we deserved. Are you with me? So why can I have recovery? Because of God's mercy. Not because you did something right, but because of who God is. He is merciful. Now let me give you the second. Recovering is always confession-based. Psalm 51, verse 2, scrub away my guilt, soak out my sins in your laundry. I know how bad I've been. My sins are staring me down. You're the one I violated. You've seen it all. Seen the full extent of my evil. You have all the facts before you. Whatever you decide about me is fair. See, it's like, I don't need justice. I'm toast. I've been out of step. This is very important. I've been out of step with you for a long time. In the wrong since before I was born. See, David says, it's not just, I didn't just have a sudden blowout. There's been issues in my life since I can remember. What you're after is truth from the inside out. Now, there's a lot of people, this idea of confession, confessing, like, yeah, I know, this is church, and I grew up with a lot of Catholics, and the confessions, and you go to confessional, and all this kind of stuff, and it's like, yeah, you got to confess, But let me tell you something about confession, biblically speaking. I want to tell you something about confessing. Confessing is not informational. It's not telling God something he doesn't know. Like, you confess something to God, he goes, I didn't know you did that. Like, no, that's not what confessing is. God knows what we did and why we did. He knows us better than we know ourselves. So confessing has nothing to do with informing. Confessing is relational. Confessing is reconnecting relationally. Confessing is bridging the gap between where I was and where I want to be. Confessing is turning my heart toward home. I love the way that Dr. Henry Cloud puts it. He writes this, a winner owns his failure and God owns his shame. When we let God forgive us, comfort us, and be with us in the sting of failure, then we can face it and own it in the way that ultimately helps us. God takes the shame of it by offering us unconditional forgiveness and acceptance. And then we can grieve, not as those who have no hope, but as those who do have hope, because we know that God is with us. Paul talks about again, godly sorrow brings a change of mind. It's right to feel bad about it, but it changes my direction, because confession is not about informing. It's how I reconnect with God. I confess to reconnect. Let me give you a third. Recovering, thirdly, always is trusting based. Like you write the word trusting. Let's pick up Psalm 51, verse 7. Purify me from my sins and I will be clean. Wash me, I'll be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy again. You've broken me, now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sin. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, oh God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence. Don't take your Holy Spirit from me. David saw that happen to King Saul. Restore to me, there it is, restoration. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and make me willing. Help me willing to obey you. What's so powerful what David does here is he stops playing God, starts trusting God to do what only God can do. Let me give you a little Bible study, just practice that I try to do in my own life. When you're reading scripture and you see a command or an order or whatever it is, ask yourself this question. Is this something God has to do, or is this something I have to do? Because you can't do God's part and he won't do yours. So if it says put on, put off, God doesn't do that, I do that. If it says change, I can't change myself, only God can change me. And in everything David writes, and I can't take more time with it, wash me, cleanse me, create a new heart within me, give me a willingness I never had, a steadfast spirit. All of these things were things David realized he could not do for himself. God, I trust you to do what I can't do. I trust you to work in me. See, you and I can take steps, but only God can transform us. So you and I come to a place where we trust God on a level we've never trusted him before. That God, I trust you to do what only you can do. And that's where strength is found, when you just trust in him. So David begins to trust God to do things he could not do. And then one more, last one. Recovering is ministering based. Ministering. Let me show you. Psalm 51, verse 13. Give me a job. Teaching rebels your ways so the lost can find their way home. Commute my death sentence, God, my salvation, God. I'll sing anthems to your life-giving ways. Make Zion the place you delight in. Repair Jerusalem's broken down walls. Why were they broken down? David broke them down. David had broken down the defenses of his own life and others. Now he prays, God, rebuild the walls. But all of this was about David saying, God, give me a job. And God did. Let me tell you something about David and about you and about me. That the gifts and callings God gave David were not destroyed when David disobeyed. David's failure did not destroy God's giftings or callings on his life. And the same is true of us. I tell you what happens when you and I fail. We lose our vision, but we don't lose our gifts, and we don't lose our calling. So let me show you from Scripture. Watch this. Paul writes, Romans 11, verse 29. I want you to read it out loud. Like I tried this in the first service, and they didn't do so well. Okay, so don't tell them. But you're going to do better, right? You give me great hope. Okay, let's read this out loud, okay, with our voices, everyone, out loud. God never changes his mind when he gives gifts or when he calls someone. And you are the someone. In fact, I want you to say, I am someone. I am someone. God thought of you before you were ever formed. He had a plan for your life before you lived a single day. And he has never changed his mind because he'd never made a mistake. And when we make mistakes, it doesn't change God's mind. He's never recalled a gift or a calling. We just lose the vision for it because of our failure. And I'm not going to tell you that everybody will applaud you and welcome you back, but I'm going to tell you this, that many, many times our greatest ministry will come out of our greatest failure. and out of our greatest hurt. Not only happened for David, it happened for Chuck Colson. Some of you know the name. Some of you are older like me. And Chuck Colson was this high-powered attorney and lawyer, became part of Nixon's team, part of Watergate. He wrote a powerful book called Born Again because he went to prison. Chuck Colson writes this. Just listen. The real legacy of my life was my biggest failure, that I was an ex-convict. My greatest humiliation, being sent to prison because of my Watergate involvement, was the beginning of God's greatest use of my life. God chose the one experience in which I could not glory for His glory. So you all think, well, God can use me when I do something. No, no, no. God uses the weak and the broken and the humble and those who have failed so that when He uses them, they'll say, you know what? It wasn't me. It was God. And Chuck Colson, when he was this powerful attorney and he failed, when he becomes this convict, he started prison ministry fellowship because he had been a prisoner. And now literally hundreds and hundreds and thousands of prisoners around the world have discovered and met Jesus Christ because God used Chuck Colson's greatest failure to create the greatest ministry experience of his life. So I got a word for you from God. We've all failed. But part of your recovery is getting back in the game. God has ministry for you. Some of your ministry may come at that very point that was your biggest failure and mistake, and you're going to run into somebody else who thinks they can't survive it, and you're going to tell them, I did. I have a friend of mine who messed up big time, and he was sharing with a group about his mess up. And afterwards, I called him. I was talking to him. I said, how'd it go? He goes, I hate that. I just hate that. I said, what? I said, I hate having to tell my story again. But I'm so glad for the people that it helped. I hate my brokenness. I hate all of that. But I thank God that sometimes He uses our greatest brokenness for our greatest ministry. Now, do you see why you and I need to put Psalm 51 in our playlist? Because it is an incredibly hope-filled song. You can't play your song backward and get all the stuff back that you lost. That's only a country song. You can't get back your mind, but you can recover, and so can I. Because David did. And in Psalm 51, he tells us, from the backstory, he tells us not only what happened, but why. And we learned some of the reasons why David messed up so that you and I can learn from our mistakes. Because if we don't learn from them, we'll repeat them. So learn from them. Why did I do what I did? But then the second thing David shares with us is the process for a full and a fresh start. Because forgiveness is instant. Restoration and recovering takes a process. And so I tell you today, there is hope for every one of us, that you and I can recover and have a great life and an amazing future. That's Psalm 51. Now I want you just to bow your heads and hearts with me just for a moment. God, I thank you for this psalm. I thank you for David's vulnerability, transparency, his honesty. God, I thank you that the Bible is finished being written so our stories don't have to be put in there and everybody can read them forever. I thank you, in fact, that our story can be forgiven and changed. God, I pray today, if you're here today or wherever you're watching, whatever time, whatever place you're listening, and you've never surrendered your life to Christ, I want you to know there is a merciful God who will not give you what you deserve because He has a bigger, better plan for you if you'll turn your heart to Him. And right where you are, just say, Jesus, forgive me of my sin, my failure. I confess to you, I have messed up. I want to follow you. I want to serve you. And I accept Jesus paying my bill because I can't. And God, I pray for many others whose failures have cost them vision and time, that today they would have a heart full of hope and strength and encouragement because you're a God of the second and third and fourth and as many chances as we need because you never change your mind about our callings or our giftings. In Jesus' name.